most great institutions begin in a small way. A newspaper editor some 75 years ago wrote,
"From a small beginning, a great college will spring. Just as from the acorn, the oak grows, we believe that unborn generations, sharing the blessings of this great institution, will bless the impulse which projected it. Just as the flowers bless the clouds which send the nourishing rains."
Now celebrating its 80th anniversary, the editor was writing about Valdosta State College. The beginnings were modest and at times difficult, but a single overriding theme has prevailed four score years: quality education with the student the center of consideration. Shortly after the turn of the century, Valdosta was reputed to be the richest town for its size in the country. The citizens felt it was high time an institution of higher learning be located in the southern half of the state, and there was no more choice location than Valdosta. Two members of the General Assembly from Lowndes County, Senator William S. West and Representative C.R. Ashley, knew the southern half of Georgia had increased more rapidly in population and wealth than the northern half. They also knew the southern half of the state had greatly increased its tax contributions to support state government. Armed with figures to support these statements, they introduced a bill to establish a state college in Valdosta. According to the Valdosta Daily Times on August 2, 1906, Ashley's persuasive powers won the day.
"On yesterday, the House took up a bill to organize, establish, and maintain a school in South Georgia as a branch of the University of Georgia. Mr. Ashley of Lowndes advocated the bill, pointing out that South Georgia was a great and growing section. The idea was to locate this school at Valdosta. Those people familiar with South Georgia know Valdosta was the leading, liveliest town down there. Good people, good buildings, good water, and good railroad facilities. A bright, brave, and growing little city. Now there are hundreds of boys and girls in South Georgia who cannot afford to go to Athens, but they are convenient to Valdosta. This school would be a great benefit to the people of South Georgia."
When Governor Joseph Terrell signed the bill into law in 1906, the first branch of the university system was established in Deep South Georgia. The city was enthusiastic, but the wheels of government ground slow. 5 years passed before the legislature funded the Act of 1906, but through the efforts of Representatives Ashley and W.L. Converse, the legislature appropriated $25,000 in 1912 and a like sum for the following year. A board of trustees was appointed by the governor. At its first meeting, the board made a decision which was to have a long-range effect. It decreed the institution should be opened to women only. The board accepted 50 acres between Patterson and Oak Streets on the northern city limits offered by Colonel West as the site for the college. Richard H. Powell, a 36-year-old native of Blakely, Georgia, was elected as the college's first president. The first priority was a building, which would set the pattern for the development of the entire campus. The board decided on a form of Spanish Mission architecture and awarded $88,000 for construction of the first building, to be completed within 1 year. The board also decided students would furnish their own eating utensils, bed linens, towels, and napkins. The students would also wear uniforms. Tuition was set at $10 per year, with board and laundry at $12 per month. It was a cold night in early January 1913. When a scared young lady from Columbus stepped off the train in Valdosta to begin her college career. The little freshman was Mary Angeline Miller, one of three women enrolled at South Georgia State Normal College. The doors of the institution were opened.
There was only one building on the campus, and it was not completed. At times we had classes in the sunshine because the heating was not finished. Because there were few students, teachers were more like tutors, and the relationship was like that of a family. The library was as small as a cubbyhole, but the teachers brought their own reference books for the young students. The classrooms and chapel were on the first floor, and the bedrooms, parlor, and dining room were on the second floor. Our first matron was Miss R.H. Patterson, a jolly, good-natured lady whom we all loved. The girls wore uniforms, even though we detested them, because it was thought to be more democratic. The town people were wonderful to us. They furnished cars to take us places, and the faculty did everything they could to make us happy and feel at home, even planning picnics and dinners for our entertainment. We were never permitted to date or be seen with a boy. However, every Monday on our free day, we went to town to Ciro's ice cream parlor for chocolate nut sundaes. Strange to say, about the same time a group of boys would get thirsty and come in. Though we could not talk to them, we exchanged sweet glances and smiles. In spite of it all, it was a wonderful experience, and we were taught the importance of refinement and of being a lady.
Before the first term ended, enrollment had grown to 34. On May 29, 1914, South Georgia State Normal College graduated its first class. Diplomas were awarded to Lucille and Minnie Arnold of Powder Springs and Mary Angeline Miller. Those early years were rewarding, although exceedingly difficult. Year after year, the administration had to choose between holding back to a junior college rating, thereby staying within the budget, or driving forward to a realization of its function as a bona fide college. A state auditor once said the natural destiny of the college lay in the direction of competition with Wesleyan and Agnes Scott, rather than with ordinary normal schools. It was truly an institution built on faith. When the college opened, the majority of the teachers in the area had no training beyond high school. In fact, a large percentage didn't even have that much. There was only one summer school in the state designed for teachers. That was in Athens. President Powell saw a great need for such a session in South Georgia, but there were no funds in the budget. The faculty agreed to take a chance, and the first summer session opened. In 1918, the second building on campus was completed. All classes moved into the domed structure, named in honor of Colonel West. The ground for West Hall was broken by the youngest child in the training school, Caroline Parrish.
Well, it occurred sometime in early 1916. They gave me a little speech to make when I broke the first dirt. And it said something to this effect. Since I am the youngest child in the youngest grade in the college, and so shall enjoy its benefits for the longest time, it gives me great pleasure to turn the first spade of dirt where our beautiful new building is to be placed.
The choice must have been an inspired one, for Miss Parrish was to spend the greater part of her life in the building. After completing her college career, she remained as secretary to the president and recorder, and eventually registrar, a position she held from 1936 until 1973, 60 years after the college opened its doors. The college shared the nation's disturbances through World War I as it continued its steady growth. The girls were very patriotic. Theirs was the first student body in the country to develop the Red Cross plan. 40,000 surgical bandages, as well as many knitted items, were sent to France. A second dormitory building was completed in 1921. The college felt the effects of inflation. Then the boll weevil destroyed the principal source of income for this section of the nation, and the Depression struck. Most schools saw their enrollment drop, but South Georgia State Normal College increased more than 100 students without lowering its standards. Exemplifying again that faith upon which the college was founded, the Board of Trustees made another move toward expansion in 1922, making the institution a four-year college granting bachelor's degrees. The legislature changed the name of the institution to Georgia State Woman's College. The first four-year class received AB degrees 2 years later. Financial woes continued to plague the institution. In 1925, half of the 24 faculty members resigned for higher pay. It became a byword with the president when asked how the college was getting along to answer,
"It's doing as well as the law allows, and we're doing everything in our power to improve the law."
The Reorganization Act of 1931 brought the 26 branches of the university under a single Board of Regents of the University System of Georgia. That new board directed that Georgia State Woman's College should become the liberal arts college for women of the university system. The board appointed Dr. Jerry N. Pound as the second president of the college in Valdosta. The 69-year-old Pike County native fell ill shortly after his arrival. He died in 1935. Pound's successor was Dr. Frank Robertson Reed. Dr. Reed brought to the college the outlook and attitudes of a typical conservative, Episcopalian Virginia gentleman, a keen sense of humor, a love of sports, and a serene but outgoing personality, which invited the confidence of student and faculty alike. He was to need all these attributes as he kept the college on an even keel during the Depression and a war. When Celeste Stumpt, daughter of Lottie Gerald of the class of 1916, enrolled in 1935, the second generation of GSWC's loving daughters was established on campus. Higher education in the state turned its attention to another war effort in the 40s. Courses were revived as more emphasis was placed on chemical warfare, electronics, radio navigation, health, first aid, and on democratic tradition and our national heritage. Courses were offered for townspeople who wished to prepare for war work and for soldiers at Moody Field. Students supported victory book and scrap metal drives, rolled bandages, and served as military maids and junior hostesses. To the girls of GSWC, one of the greatest casualties of the war was the retirement in 1943 of Annie Poe Hopper, their beloved Dean of Women. For more than two decades, Ms. Hopper's unflinching example and firm hand had guided hundreds of college girls. Her influence did not stop at the edge of the campus, but many male citizens of Valdosta will admit they are better men because Ms. Hopper met them in the rotunda when they called on the college girls.
She never gave in. You didn't beg her to do anything, and her word was law. It really was. And yet Miss Hopper was a friendly person. Yes, they liked her. I think they kind of dreaded her sometimes. They didn't know how to take her.
A great lady, and I was very fond of her. Enjoyed working with her. And of course, she was the Dean of Women when I came along, and then was a co-worker, I guess you would say, when I became registrar. One Sunday, some of the girls decided they'd like to chat with some of the boys that hung around downtown. Instead of going to church, they went into a funeral home that was there on West Hill Avenue. Miss Hopper, of course, found out about the fact that they were not at church and called them in on account of it. And one of the girls was reputed to have said to Miss Hopper, we just went up there to look at the caskets was all. And she said, oh, Miss Hopper, I wish I were in one right now.
Truly an era ended in the home life of GSWC when Miss Hopper retired. The college continued its growth. In 1941, Powell Library was dedicated by the nation's first lady, Miss Eleanor Roosevelt. On March 9, 1949, Dr. J. Ralph Thaxton became the college's fourth president. A native of Griffin and a graduate of the University of Georgia, he rose to the educational ranks at the university. Like his predecessors at GSWC, he had a deep commitment to the liberal arts. Post-war students brought a new maturity to the campus. They were no longer college girls, but college women. And with their coming, a different sort of breeze stirred the pines. Men had invaded their sacred halls as summer school day students for several years and during World War II. A few local men had been allowed to enroll. This group, known as the Measly 13, had made no great splash.
In the early 40s, there was a lot of stress on campus in that many of the ladies on campus had friends and relatives that was in service. And this was not an ideal time for any kind of a transition. And early on, in the year of the Measly 13, it became obvious that we were not the most accepted things in the world, and the further it got, the worse it got.
A new order came about in 1950, when the Board of Regents decreed GSWC should become co-educational, and changed the name to Valdosta State College. Some 28 men registered that spring, and the transition was underway. In June 1951, Tom Crouch, one of the Measly 13, and George B. Morgan, Jr., became the first male graduates of Valdosta State College.
Acceptance was much better because there was a different administration. Dr. Thaxton had made inroads into it, and peoples that we had had experience with early, back in the early 40s, for the most part, had turned around completely, and the men were totally accepted, and we participated in all the activities that was allowable.
Following the Korean conflict, there was another influx of veterans, and VSC's enrollment climb continued. The property of Emory at Valdosta, now known as North Campus, was given to the college in 1953, enabling VSC to effect much-needed expansion. The 50s and 60s brought other changes. College entrance examination test scores became an admission requirement in 1956. Dr. Thaxton's claim that VSC had the best faculty in the university system was affirmed when two department heads were called to become presidents of other institutions. The college had its first graduating class of more than 100 in 1959. The Department of Physics and Chemistry carried on experimental work with radioisotopes under a grant from the Atomic Energy Commission. Georgia's fairest gift to her daughters, still the only senior college in the southern half of the state, was serving even more of Georgia's sons. Robert Lee Pierce, Jr. and Drunell Thomas were among the freshmen enrolling at Valdosta State in September 1963. Their enrollment went without fanfare, although it had been preceded by nervous anticipation. There had been no problems with race relations in Valdosta, and the voluntary desegregation of Valdosta State College was quiet. 4 years later, Pierce and Miss Thomas completed their studies and became the first blacks to earn degrees from VSC. In 1966, Dr. S. Walter Martin became the fifth president of the college. Under his administration, a period of expansion in physical facilities, curriculum, and enrollment began.
I knew that Valdosta State College was going to grow, and I knew the other units in the system were going to grow because 5 years prior to my coming down here, I was vice chancellor of the university system of Georgia in Atlanta. And one of the things we did was to study the future needs of college students in the state of Georgia. We studied the needs of all the various schools and colleges in the university system. And of course, this is one of the reasons that I was happy to come to Valdosta State College, because it gave so much promise of growth and expansion. Library was one of the first buildings we felt that we needed when we came. There was certainly not space, not enough room of any kind in the old library. And we got the Board of Regents to give us an appropriation for an expansion of the old library. And we soon found out that we couldn't expand the old library. We had several library consultants to come in and tell us that it was not practical to try to expand that old library. So we took the $800,000, which the Board of Regents had given us for a library, and they allowed us to use it to increase and enlarge Nevin's Hall. And then we had to go back and get money for the library, which cost a little over $2 million. With more students, we needed more majors, we needed more degrees, we needed an expansion of the academic program. And the Board of Regents was willing to let us have it because of the expansion of the student body. In 1966, the student body was about 1,800, and there was dramatic increases each year thereafter. Soon after we arrived, we reorganized the whole college into to different schools and divisions. For instance, the School of Arts and Sciences, the School of Business Administration, the Division of Fine Arts, the Division of Nursing, and the Graduate Division, and we gave degrees in each of those areas. The growth of the academic program kept pace with the growth of the physical expansion on the campus, and at the same time the coming in of the large number of students, because some years we'd have as many as 500 new students coming in each fall.
Dr. Hugh C. Bailey became the sixth president of the college in 1978. A soft-spoken native of Alabama who conquered polio at a young age, Dr. Bailey brought with him a caring concern for students and a vision for the future. Under his leadership, Valdosta State has moved to the forefront of educational innovation in Georgia and the Southeast.
We're certainly proud of the consistency of the philosophy that has motivated Valdosta State College through the years. It remains the same. We're concerned primarily with the student, first and always. We have, and we will continue to have, excellent academic programs taught by professors who have been chosen for their expertise in their subject matter and for their scholarly attainments and their desire to work with students. And secondly, that philosophy, the philosophy of ESC, is one that seeks to find the innate talents of students and to help them attain the height of their accomplishments in their chosen field. These will continue to be the primary motivations for the philosophy behind VSC. It has succeeded in the past. No institution has alums who have attained greater heights of whom it can be more proud than we at VSC. And we are confident that the current students and those who will come to us in the future will continue that noble tradition.
The early day rebels are now the Blazers. But in 30 years of intercollegiate athletic competition, a championship tradition has been established.
Valdosta State has come a long way since NAIA days of 1954, fielding one baseball and one basketball team. The college now fields 10 varsity sports in NCAA's Division II and plays in the toughest Division II conference in the country, the Gulf South Conference. And we have a trophy case full of tournament championships, conference championships, and even one national championship. The Blazer men's basketball team has claimed conference championships 15 times in 30 years. The Lady Blazer basketball team recorded a 30-3 record in 1984, reaching the Final Four in the Division II national championships in Springfield, Massachusetts. One of the high points of Valdosta State athletics came on a spring day in 1979 in Springfield, Illinois, when the Blazer baseball team won the national championship. Another big highlight came in 1982 when Valdosta State fielded its first ever football team, and South Georgia fans had to only wait until the second game before the city known as Wintersville had its newest winner. Those who said VSC would be lucky to win a single game the first year were astonished. The first Blazer squad went 5-5-1. The college can also boast one of its lettermen, All-America Mark Catano, who now helps anchor the line of the NFL's Pittsburgh Steelers.
Second down and 11. Newsom again in motion. Danielson is sacked. That's Mark Catano, who now is filling in for the injured Gary Dunn as the Steelers rotate their defensive linemen. There's Catano right at the nose tackle, just tossing off Mike Babb. Good move by Catano. He had two men on him at one time. The right guard also blocked him. From Valdosta State. You don't see a lot of Valdosta Staters around.
Along with football came the Blazing Brigade marching band. Valdosta State assembled not only an outstanding group of musicians, but another step was taken toward the institution's commitment to excellence. That commitment was made by such men as Colonel William West, Representative C.R. Ashley, and Dr. Richard Powell. It has been continued by men and women who guided the institution four score years. They realized there is a vast reservoir of talent and educational interest in South Georgia. Through VSC, individuals have the opportunity to reach their potential and to create a better life. Valdosta State College, dedicated to nothing less than the best in all we do.